everyone. So today I'm going to start my talk with a question. What can you make with some fabric and thread? Now, Ria gave you a very good example. My talk was supposed to be before her. But now you know what you can make with fabric and thread. But still, I'm going to ask you the same question again, because this fabric and thread are insignificant items in your home. Sometimes you don't even remember where you have kept them. But they can play a very important role in your life. So what can you make with some fabric and thread? Something like this, the creative minds in the group, handkerchiefs, and maybe some embroideries. Now, if I ask you what comes to your mind when you see think about a sewing machine, I'm sure this is the picture. Maybe it might be Nirupa Roy in her place, but the picture is usually the same, you know, an old dilapidated house, a light bulb flickering, there are cobwebs around, and an old Bollywood ma, the quintessential ma, sewing late into the night. So now I'll ask you another question. What comes to your mind when I say quilts? So there is a big question mark most of the times. So then I'll tell you the Marathi word for it, godhadi. What comes to your mind when I say godhadi? Surely something like this. Some version of it, maybe your grandma in that lady's place. But definitely not me, right? I'm too modern, I'm too educated to fit that picture. I'm an architect. And I practiced for like 8 years before I took up something like this. And I did residential, commercial, and industrial projects. I climbed up like 150 meters to check the slab of a silo. So that is where I come from. And from there to upcycling old clothes on a sabbatical was a very downhill journey for me. Like a slide, basically, not even the stairs. It went too fast. And my mom actually told me, you are an architect and you've done so many projects. And I don't have the right word for that profession, but she I'll just quote her sentence to you. Tu evdi architect jalis an boharanicha kaam kay kartis? That was her question. And that is a question that a lot of people have asked me when I went from architecture to quilting. This is my studio. This is where I work. It's not dingy, no cobwebs. There might be some, but it's not dingy. There are no cobwebs, and definitely not the quintessential Bollywood ma at the machine. So my journey has been exciting. It has been thrilling. I started with upcycling old clothes way back in 2009 when I stopped working as an architect on a sabbatical because I contacted chikungunya. And my son was young, and I needed something to do while I was sitting at home. So my journey began, but gradually I started loving it. But there was just one small problem. I didn't have a sewing machine that I could use. I had that black one, kar, 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 kar. So my maid used to actually thread the machine because I could never figure out how to thread it. And if she left and I wanted to change the thread or if the thread broke, I just kept it away, waited for her to come the next day, and then start sewing again. So I wanted the picture to change, and I decided to buy a sewing machine, and I called up the best brand. You know, when you want to buy a phone, you always think you'll buy an Apple. Then you check your wallet. Then you go for a Lenovo, a Sony, or maybe MI, or whatever. So I called up the guys who sold like the best machines. I knew which model I wanted, and I told them I want this model. And I had 10,000 rupees. I didn't tell them that. I thought that was a lot of money 10 years back to buy a sewing machine. They quoted the price. It was 1,58,000. I said, I could buy a Nano with that kind of money. Why would I buy a sewing machine? Because in my mind, I still had Nirupa Roy. So Nirupa Roy would rather spend that much money to buy a car than a sewing machine, definitely. Because she still has that dingy house. So I decided that I want the lowest end model. And that was 80,000 rupees. So then I had to compromise and buy another lower brand, which was 12,500. Still not enough money. But I managed. That is where my journey started. And it grew. And today, I'm a brand ambassador of the same brand. And 10 8 years later, I bought a machine that actually costs more than all the two-wheelers in the house put together. So during my journey, I experimented a lot with quilts. Now, quilts are basically godadis. So what can you experiment on a godadi? But I use that, being an architect helped me there. So I use that to express myself. So this was one quilt that I made, which was internationally acclaimed. It is called the White Rainbow. It is basically completely white, but still it's a rainbow. It is my interpretation of what colors mean to those who have never seen them. It was inspired by a novel by Daniel Steele. The novel was not that good, but the quilt came out of it. So I love the model, the book. So basically, it has got the names of colors written in Braille that people can actually touch and read. So red, orange, yellow, those are the colors over there in Braille. And this was exhibited in Austin at QuiltCon and was sold there. So I actually sell my quilts, I do, for $500. So I was pretty naive then. I won't charge $500 now. I would charge much more. So this quilt took me places. And it made me realize that I could use quilting not just to make household items, but to express myself. Then came stage two. This is what I call Unpicked. This was a project by Bernina. They sent us a pictogram. A pictogram is an image that we use instead of a word or a sentence. So this was the pictogram that they sent me, a girl pictogram. And during that time, there were a lot of cases of female feticide around us, in Sangli and in Satara also. So this was my natural reaction as a woman to those cases. You know, I actually stitched down the girl, and then I unpicked it. And every stitch that I unpicked, I realized that is what those doctors do. They unpick the fetus from the womb of the woman just because it's a girl. So it was, this quilt made me feel very free. And it gave me an idea of what potential quilt making had. But at the same time, I was very intrigued. Actually, I never looked at godadis till then. But when Modern Quilt Guild had a convention in Savannah and they asked me to be a speaker and speak about Indian godadis, I was like, 45 minutes of talking about godadis? What am I going to talk? But then I started my research. And these quilts are not just quilts. They tell you stories about where they come from. So I'm just going to share a few stories with you. These are the quilts made by the Nandibaili community. You know the Nandibaili who comes to your house and then there is even a song about it in Marathi. So everyone knows that. But did you know that the women folk of that community make quilts? And they make such bright and colorful quilts because they are all in the Sahyadri ranges surrounded by the natural beauty. The climate is awesome. There is inspiration everywhere and it percolates right into their quilts. Even their profession, you know, their quilts a lot of times have moon, stars, and the planets on them, symbols of that. Or a version of the image, the format of the patrika that we have, a diamond and a cross. So a lot of versions of that pattern are seen in their quilts. Even in this quilt, you can see that influence. So there are occupational influences also. So this quilt tells a lot of stories. Then these are the quilts made by women from Vidarbh. So with limited means and really hard, harsh living conditions, these women use this medium as a medium to express, come together, talk to each other. It's a community event over there, stitching a godadi. But as you can see, the quilt mostly is made of an entire piece of fabric rather than small pieces because they don't want to waste anything. Then these are quilts that are very peculiar and they are only found in the Konkan region. Now why Konkan region? And these quilts are very similar to the quilts that are made by the Western cultures. Now why are these quilts only limited to the Konkan region? That is because Konkan was the first point of contact for the European invaders. So if you say Konkan has spent a lot more time with the Europeans than the rest of India. So that is where these influences came from, and that those are reflected in their quilt making styles. And then in Sangli, Kolhapur area, you have this devotion to the goddess over here. So Ambabai, everyone, like all the women worship her almost. So these women have a ritual when they complete a quilt. So here the quilts are made from outside in. And the last piece is in the center, which they call the stomach of the quilt. So before they attach that last piece, they will perform a puja of Annapurna Devi and then put a little bit of jaggery, rice and dal inside the quilt and close the stomach. That is supposed to bless the person who uses the quilt. So these quilts tell the story of the devotion of those women. So these quilts, actually the regional quilts of our country, I'm just talking about Maharashtra today, but every region of our country has a different style of quilt making. I just showed you around 4 to 5. There are 20 types of just godaris that are made in Maharashtra. These quilts have witnessed wars, invasions. They have witnessed revolutions. They have witnessed different rulers. Right, starting with monarchy and then coming down to democracy. They've seen the freedom struggle and they tell all those stories in their layers. But still, we ignore them. Just like when we wake up and we throw away our blanket, these quilts have been thrown away. There is no documentation about it. When I was researching for my lecture, I couldn't find documentation about it anywhere. It is still considered to be something that old and poor women do. Not a lot of educated women take it up as a hobby or even a profession. There are NGOs now who have started getting these quilts done from the rural women of India and displaying them at international quilt exhibitions and selling them there. But what I see very starkly is the price tag over there, which says like $500 to $1,200, and the amount that is paid to the woman who makes it, which is barely 2,000 to 2,500 rupees. I want to bridge this gap. But to do that, I need a lot more educated women to take this up as a profession, or even a hobby, or even a social cause. It doesn't matter why you are doing this. You want to make money out of it, do it. You want to get satisfaction out of it, do it. Just do it. So that is why when I decided that if I wanted to elevate the level of this art, I want to make it glamorous. And how can you add glamour to a medium unless you make some art with it? So if I start selling my quilts for a price like $1,000, $2,000, yes, people are going to be attracted to it. So I decided portraits is an art form that everyone understands. You don't need to be an art expert to analyze. You can just look at that thing and say, okay, it looks like him, you have done a good job. So I started making portraits in quilts. This piece took me it has 3,500 pieces, and it took me about 3 months to finish. And at the end, I realized I loved making portraits, but if it took 3 months to make another one, I'm never making one again. So I needed an easier method. So this was the next one that I made. I hope you guys can recognize him. So this took me like 15 hours to finish. That was a method that I developed myself. And now I teach that. I've taught it to more than 250 women. And I have traveled everywhere. This method has taken me everywhere to teach. I've taught in Chennai, Bangalore, Pune, Hyderabad, Mumbai. And I'm teaching in the US in February. So it's going to take me places. But my true potential as a quilter was tested when I decided to make this. Especially in Maharashtra, every artist wants to pay homage to the greatest warrior king that the country has seen through their art, be it rangoli or painting. I didn't want to be left behind. So last year, in March, I started on this journey of piecing together 22,888 pieces, some of which were like this small. So I started on that journey, and it took me 700 hours to finish this over a period of 10 months. And you can ask my family, I didn't do anything else at home. I just made tea in the morning, and that only because my cook didn't come that early. So I had to give, I stopped doing everything else and I concentrated just on making this quilt. But that was my aim, because this quilt was recognized in the media that the common person knew. Social media, television, and even the print. So it reached a lot more people. People knew what quilting was. For the first time, people were aware about the word quilt. And I feel that it is a major step in the direction that I want to go, where I want to glamorize this art. I want to see Katrina Kaif next time sitting on that machine and quilting. So that journey is pretty far right now, but I believe that this is a major step in that direction. And so now that I come to the end of my talk, I'm once again going to ask you the question that I asked you at the beginning. What can you do with some fabric and thread? Thank you.